banking institutions are really the heart and soul of the economy. Transactions take place through banking systems, and as we expand and grow, and a greater formalization of the economy takes place, the role of the banking system itself increases. And this is one area where you contribute to nation building, through support to industry, to support to individuals. And that support really is of invaluable help to these sections. Regrettably, only controversies make news. A lot of work that is done goes unnoticed. And I must therefore start by acknowledging the fact that India's banking system has really spread itself across the country. And in the growth process of this country in the last few decades, its contribution has been second to none. My own experience over the last 4 years has been that India has achieved financial inclusion at a pace which is more rapid than any other economy in the world. With a population as large as we have in India, to reach every household is no mean achievement. And therefore, for the banking system to reach every household and bring it within the ambit and the benefits of the banking system is something which has to be really acknowledged. And on the strength of that financial inclusion, to make sure that it's not only the large industries or the medium industries, but small businesses, micro businesses, farmers, and others who also get a huge amount of support as far as the banking system is concerned. The runaway success of the Jan Dhan campaign of the banks, the very large success of the Mudra Yojana, the marketing of the low-cost insurance pension schemes is something that India's banking and allied institutions have achieved. But having said this, I think we really have to look at the scenario in the country in the midst of the global situation today, and then analyze where do we stand as far as the banking institutions are concerned, what are our challenges, and what is it that we need to re-prepare ourselves. There is an uncertain world global situation. In fact, post-2008, it has really not settled down. Events take place with frequency, which in a globalized world impact on every economy in some measure or the other. If we look at our own position, I think as we stand today, what doesn't appear to be a great problem, and it seems to be an optimistic picture, is that we are continuing our run as a fast-growing economy in the world. In fact, the last 4 years we've been the fastest-growing economy in the world, And I have no doubt in my mind that for the next few years, we'll continue to occupy that sweet spot.
Even this year, I have little doubt that our growth rate is going to be somewhat higher than what conventionalists are projecting. And there are several indications which come. The current consumption boom, the hugely expanding middle class and the new middle class, the purchasing power which is expanding by the day, a good monsoon this year. In fact, last 3 years we've been privileged to have a better monsoon. Prior to that we had two bad years. And therefore, correspondingly the credit uptake building up, I think settles that key worry as far as the domestic growth is concerned. Our macroeconomic fundamentals have been reasonably sound. And if at all any gets impacted, it's not going to be on account of any internal factors. The management of the economy has reasonably disciplined itself in decision making as far as the internal factors are concerned. Our challenges are really external. And in the external challenges, the unpredictability and the volatility of the oil prices, which is on account of either created shortages or on account of some geopolitical issues. And I am keeping my fingers crossed, hopefully, that these challenges will not go on indefinitely. They have to resolve themselves. That's how the world moves. Coupled with this is the challenge of trade wars. Though we are not an active participant in this, but the impact and the footprints of that can be seen in India, particularly when there is a tendency of some large economies to either devalue or undervalue their currencies, and therefore that has a regional impact which also impacts us. And of course then there are sporadic political issues which impact on the economy of some country, and that has a spiral effect across the world, Turkey being the latest example. And if we see our key challenges over the last few months, it's really been the external factors. And therefore, it is all the more incumbent on us to ensure that our domestic parameters are kept strong, that we have the resilience to face the challenge of these external factors. High growth rate, fiscal prudence, a lot of economic activity in the domestic market, and conventionally with a series of reforms which have taken place in the last few years have certainly helped the economy. And in a growing economy, the obvious advantage is that even revenues grow. The last 4 years have seen both the assessee base and the taxation collections, because of use of technology, some other policy decisions taken by the government and the growth of the economy, the coffers of the government also improve. And therefore the ability of the government to spend on infrastructure, to spend on social infrastructure, to spend, make investments in rural areas, enhance government spending, also leads to a spiral as far as economic activity is concerned. But then we cannot move our eyes away from the fact that one of the key domestic challenges for the last few years has been the challenge to the banking institutions itself. And this challenge really has, over the last one decade, a history. I do not believe in a blame game, because a blame game doesn't resolve the roadmap for the future. But it is extremely important for all of us to learn the relevant lessons. And one lesson that I have learned is that when we desire to have a high growth rate, it must be accompanied by strong macroeconomic fundamentals. If we start sacrificing our macroeconomic fundamentals in order to temporarily push up the growth, then we are hurting ourselves elsewhere. And that is bound to strike back at the economy at some point of time. And therefore, for the management of the economy, growth with fiscal prudence, growth with macroeconomic fundamentals, and therefore growth with the normal reasonable credit offtake. And therefore, if we have growth which is engineered on the strength of a 31% or a 28% credit offtake in a given year, then history will certainly record it as some indiscriminate lending, which is bound to show its impact on a future date. And I think this is one lesson that all of us must learn from. Moderation, rather than just running after figures. And the result of this has been that we ended up creating surplus capacities when we did that kind of indiscriminate lending about a decade ago. We ended up funding projects which were unable to service the kind of debt that they had created. And needless to say, some of them must also have indulged in fraudulent practices, as some more controversial cases have shown. And once we commit that error, the next error that we committed was that we started dressing up. And therefore, once you dress up, you start evergreening the entire money which are owed to the banking system. Having said that, I think we then, in the third phase, struggled to find methodologies of how to effect recoveries. The Reserve Bank came out with certain schemes, the bankers tried it. And I had earlier, while addressing the State Bank of India conclave through this very mechanism, I had said, we had created a system where we had reduce the ability of our bankers also to find solutions. Because the regime under which we wanted them to function was not a regime of comfort. It is not, everybody must be accountable. But we were holding them accountable even for honest decisions that they took. Some element of play of joints in commercial transactions must exist. And therefore, some commercial judgment must be left to the wisdom of the bankers itself. We had a vague penal law, the Prevention of Corruption Act, which was a carryover of the regulatory regime because it was enacted in 1988, pre-1991. And therefore, the indiscriminate use of it, even in relation to honest decisions, which by passage of time turned out to be either erroneous or didn't commercially succeed. I think we reduced the ability of the bankers to settle those issues. And therefore, we landed ourselves in a situation where a high debt had been created. We were dressing up the debt. The various circulars and the systems that we had created were not able to adequately resolve it. And then, one of the factors which led to disability or inability to resolve was the fear of consequences. And therefore, it's extremely important for us to mince no words and honestly analyze as to the root cause of the problems that have arisen before us. Indiscriminate lending to chase growth at the cost of macroeconomic fundamentals was a policy mistake. Dressing up was a consequence. The resolution mechanism was inadequate. And the consequences of the resolution mechanism were fearful and penal. And therefore, you needed to learn from this and rewrite the system. Fortunately, it took all of us some time to honestly realize the root causes. We now have been putting systems in place in order to strengthen this situation. And those systems have led to the creation of the IBC. Since it has a statutory backing and resolution is by a quasi-judicial process, I think it's redefined the creditor-debtor relationship as far as India is concerned. We lived in a society where the creditor would indefinitely chase the debtor. Today the roles have been reversed. Debtors had also learned how to get around the Securitization Act. That was one measure which had also changed this relationship, but they had learned how to get around it. And I think this arrangement is working satisfactorily. There has been some early harvest. And therefore, the need now is that we expedite the process. And for expediting the process, I am given to understand that we need to even augment our capacities as far as the NCLT and the NCELT are concerned, that is something which is work in progress. And I'm sure over the next few months, this will lead to the further expedition of this process. This chain of relationship has also had a salutary effect. When we brought the first amendment to Section 29A, the whole idea was to prevent the defaulting promoters from bidding. And the ethical principle behind that was that if the defaulting promoter bids and gets back the company at, let us say, a fraction of the original cost, then nothing changes except the bankers having taken the hit or the creditors having taken the hit. And that would have been something which in at least a country like India, neither to the banking system nor to the public opinion or the political process, would have been very palatable. And therefore that amendment was brought. But I now understand that that amendment has also led to an unintended consequence, which is that future defaulters realize that the consequence of default would be that you would be disabled under Section 29A, and therefore it is much better to prevent that fateful day and not allow the red line to be crossed. This itself is an indication of the changing the relationship between the debtor and the creditor itself. As this process goes on, I do hope that you are able to revive some part of your financial potential, and what you have already been providing for gets factored in, and therefore your numbers see a significant improvement itself. I had mentioned when I had last met some of you at the SBI conference that I had for the last 4 years been repeatedly advocating that a pre-liberalization prevention of corruption act with vague language, which even provided for honest decisions which turn out to be erroneous or which commercially did quite succeed despite the best of intention, cannot attract the penal consequences of corruption. I had first mooted this idea at a lecture I had delivered, an annual lecture at the CBI, is annual lecture function. And since then the law has been worked out, and I am now glad that in the last session of Parliament that law has finally been passed, it has received approval, and that's now law of the land. And therefore, unless there is a criminal intention, these commercial decisions cannot be imputed as a corruption crime. Now, this has hugely empowered civil servants. This has empowered those who take commercial decisions in various public sector undertakings. And this has certainly empowered bankers to take honest decisions. And therefore, this has also empowered all of you outside the IBC process to take honest decisions which you think are in the interest of your banking system based on commercial prudence, which are going to resolve the challenges before the banks itself. You are the best judges. And therefore, I think these are two, there have been several changes which have been made. I am not getting into the whole ambit of changes which have been made with regard to which promote further formalization of the economy, which will bring more and more people into the banking system, more back into the banking activity. But at the end of the day, you have a very large onerous responsibility. This country's infrastructure program, besides government, is supported by you. This country's industry is supported by you. The small scale industry is supported by you. The employment generation in this country depends on that. And if you go down, the agricultural credit is provided by you. The Mudra Yojana is funded by you. So virtually you are the lifeline of the economy. And it is in the interest of India's economic sovereignty and growth that you have to be strengthened. Your credibility to the utmost has to be maintained. And therefore, it is an onus on you also to make sure that what is popularly termed as frauds on banks also are avoided, because stray instances of this kind, single instances of this kind, also raise serious question marks and take the focus away from all the good that you have been doing. If you look down the tunnel as to what is the roadmap we have, the roadmap is very important. Today we are the sixth largest economy in the world. Barring China, which grows at about 6.5%, we are the only ones growing at 7.5+. The other four in the top six are much bigger economies but growing at a relatively smaller rate. And therefore, some of them, I think one of them we may be able to overtake next year itself, because the gap is very narrow. Their populations are small and therefore their per capita is much larger than us. But in size we'll be bigger and probably be the fifth next year. And then over the next few years we have to target those who are number four and number three and overtake them. So if we look at our roadmap over the next 10 to 20 years, with the kind of investments taking place in India, with the kind of economic activity taking place in India, our additional resources are going into infrastructure, they are going into more organized and urbanized cities, creation of new smart cities. A lot of investment is going into rural India, which is going to see a facelift. And once this activity takes place and we continue to grow, I am reasonably optimistic that over the next several years we are going to continue at a high trajectory growth rate. And therefore the role of the banking institutions is going to be vital. And the challenges therefore are of professionalism, of expansion, of credibility, and the net effect of all this is of strengthening the economy of the country itself. I am sure undeterred at times by stray instances which tend to create an environment of hostility, you will continue this single-minded pursuit of the service to the country through the banking system, because your role was very vital in the past. It's going to be certainly more vital in the days and years to come. And I'm sure this year when you meet at your AGM, besides the formal agendas that you have, you will also introspect the journey of the last few years, which has been very challenging, and search for the better roadmap as far as the banking system is concerned. Let me once again thank you for having invited me to address you.